Welcome to Breaking Down Bits, a conversation about great comedy bits with the comedians who wrote and performed them.
Welcome to Breaking Down Bits. I'm Brian Gendron.
I'm Drew Jordan. We're happy to be back, knocking out some podcasts, having some great conversations about comedy. Another great way to have a conversation about comedy is to pop in on that Breaking Down Bits feedback mic every Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern, share some jokes, get some feedback, maybe get a tag, help other comics from around the nation and around the globe do the same. It's just such a fun time. And we'd love to have you in there. It's also just fun to meet people who listen to the podcast and get some hang time. So do that every Tuesday, 9 p.m. Eastern. We'd love to have you.
Yeah, you can email us in at breakingdownbits@gmail.com. Ask us for a spot on the following Tuesday or just give us a date and we'll get you on. Or you can DM us on, slide into the DMs on Instagram or Facebook or wherever you find us at Breaking Down Bits.
Yes.
Those have been a lot of fun, and iron sharpens iron. It's been helping me really grow my comedy. So come check us out. Come hang with us. Let's go ahead and talk about callbacks, man. We just had our man, Mr. Plitt, on. What do you think?
Yeah, Jeff was great. Very technical, very smart, very organized guy. I think one of the things that was super interesting that I've heard before and I've seen it before, but I totally forgot about it, was this late night writer. I forgot the name. But it's this list of transitions, and it's like and that's weird because when asked for a comment, he replied, and it's all these little transitions you can put after, because he uses them for like monologue style jokes for like headlines. But it's a fun way to get yourself unstuck if you have like an idea and you're trying to write a joke and you don't quite have an angle. Sometimes all it takes is just the right little transition to put your brain on the right path. So, you know, we'll probably share that online, or you can Google that transitions list. We'll figure out. We'll try to remember which late night writer that was. But just a great little technique.
Yeah, we often talk about prompts, which is to get you started, but rarely do we talk about what keeps you going. And those transitions are absolutely a way to do that. I like that as well, Drew. One of the other things that I took away from Jeff's incredible process is he talks about writing monologue jokes and using Feedly as a tool to curate headlines from pop culture, from political, from, you know, world news. And then he uses those to write punchlines and tags. And so just a way to continuously be writing. He said he sits down and he writes 30 in 2 hours. And he's very disciplined about how he goes through that. And he even talked about not spending too much time on one joke, just moving on to the next, kind of like test taking as a kid. So just methodical, and seems like he does this week in, week out, holds himself accountable. His whole process is really interesting. But Feedly is something where I'm going to welcome back news into my life to start creating more comedy.
Also, I feel like we have to double call back. This is a Breaking Down Bits exclusive, the double callback. Another thing that I think we can't, I haven't heard anyone really talk about, is the fact that he has a group of dudes. We workshop jokes all the time with friends, but he workshops these TikTok videos, and he'll send them to friends, get feedback, see which ones connect. I think a lot of times we just create something and hit send and it just goes out to our social media. And maybe we don't employ the same rigorous testing and trying and editing that we do on stage online. So that's an interesting thought. Like, hey, before I post my next video, or if I have a couple of videos that I'm considering posting, maybe I send those all to a couple of friends that I trust their opinion on, see which ones they connect with, see which ones they like the most. Just a little more data to work with before you decide what to share. It could help you be just that much more successful.
Absolutely. Well, go ahead and make sure you go listen to that episode and all of our episodes on breakingdownbits.com. You can find them there. You can also find them all on YouTube and wherever it is you get your podcasts. You want to get a guest in?
Yeah, let's go for it.
Originally from San Francisco, Caitlin Peluffo is a comedian currently living in Brooklyn, New York. She started her stand-up career after a brief six-year stint in art school where she studied performative video art, which is apparently a thing. Peluffo's opened for comedians like Maria Bamford, Gilbert Godfrey, Gary Gulman, and Colin Quinn. You can see her in New York and touring clubs nationwide, and she's also participated in the Breakout Artist Series for Caroline's on Broadway.
Hey, Caitlin, how you doing? Thanks for coming on.
Oh, thanks for having me. This is great. What a fun little video.
definitely ripped a lot from your bio, and your college degree was...
Oh, yeah. It's real. It's technically, they call it new forms, but okay. It was photography, video, and performance is what I did.
But yeah. sounds like a really great degree for someone who wants to do comedy.
Not you would think all the buzzwords, but really not helpful at all. I use none of it. Also, I was screaming. It's Lori Kilmartin is the writer who had that.
Yep.
I was just screaming into the abyss, and he kept telling me my mic was off. I was like, Lori, it's Lori Kilmartin. And she also just came out with a new album. So everybody should check out Lori Kilmartin. She's wonderful. She was actually a big hero of mine when I first started. So
nice.
I love her.
Thanks for listening on the intro. We appreciate
that. Yeah. Hey, I'm you got me for an hour, baby, and I will give it my all.
That's awesome.
The way we start our show, Caitlin, is we'd like to learn about you and your career trajectory. So we know about your degree.
Sure.
Unless your stand-up started before you went to college, which some people have. Talk to us about early going and stand-up, how you got involved, and then, you know, sort of your trajectory, any breaks you had along the way. Give us your journey.
Yeah, sure. My journey. Oh, my God, that belongs on a pillow. my comedy journey started later. I started when I was 27. I always wanted to do it, but I didn't quite have the guts. I thought you really needed to go to like performance school, like theater, or be a writer or something in order to do comedy. And then I did my first open mic and I was like, oh, anybody can do this. It does not. There is no requirement. I started
like to any open mic.
Oh my God. I mean, the mentally unhinged go. So it's just like, oh, I'm fine. I started, what happened was I didn't know how to start at all. I just knew I wanted to do stand-up because I'd been a fan for a long time, but not to the point of understanding the process. Back then, there weren't as many podcasts as there are now. So I didn't know how to write a joke or any that open mics were even a thing. So I literally Googled how to do stand-up comedy and or how to start. And there was like a free seminar one of those like comedy schools or whatever, you know, the ones that are always just trying to steal your money. They did like a free workshop. And then at the end, they gave away a class. They pulled a name out of the hat and it was me. And so I had no choice but to do comedy then. And then I didn't look back. I did that class and I was like, oh, the shoe fits. And then from then I, kind of just nonstop. In New York, you can really do like 15 million mics a day. So it was from 0 to 100 for me, I would say. And
how many really though, do you think at your peak, like open mic?
Oh, 30, 30 a week. Yeah. And that was working nights. I worked in a restaurant 3 nights a week. So you could really get after it. You would do like 4 or 5 at night. And so you don't really have friends. Your friends become open mic people. And that's just you build a community really fast. And that's why I think New York comics kind of have the rep of being very efficient and very like punchline driven, because you do these open mics and you have maybe 2 to 5 minutes. And so you get up, you start right away, you go, and then you literally leave and go to the next mic and you do it all over again. It takes a lot to be noticed because there's 30 to 40 comics at every mic. And so it literally weeds out the week very quickly. But I was like kind of an old bitch when I started. So I was like, these toddlers can't hurt me, you know? So yeah, what are they going to say that I haven't already said in therapy? So I just kind of took off running. And I was able to make friends quickly. And then hosting was the biggest thing that helped me get out of the open mic scene. And I still do open mics. I have nothing against open mics. I do them when I need them. But hosting was the biggest help for me. That got me into clubs quickly, and that got me on the road quickly.
What aspect of hosting?
Yeah, how does that work?
Yeah,
hosting. Well, that same company, Laughing Buddha, they ran mics. They ran like 3 mics a night, and they were expensive though. You had to pay $5 to do the mic, and then another $5 for a drink. So it was $10 to do a mic, and I couldn't afford that. And so they said, if you host, you can do it for free. And so I was like, great, I'll host these open mics. And that gets you really strong because you're going up first and then you're doing short bits in between to keep the energy high. So it really makes you think on your feet and be present. I think that's being present is such a important part of comedy that people don't really talk about. They're like joke writing, joke structure. No, you have to be in the room because we're all looking at the same shit, you know? So it's, that was a really good lesson to learn. And then just thinking quick on your feet and not being afraid to talk to people. I think I've never been afraid to hold a conversation. And so that helps with like hosting, you know, if someone speaks out, you're not like, oh, what do I do? You're just like, shut up, bitch. Or just like, you just kind of talk to them like a nice person. But now I think I'm meaner. But before I was nice. I was like, oh, and what are your hopes and dreams? And but now I'm like, you better shut the hell up, you know. But
do a full-on counseling session as the host up on the stage.
Exactly, exactly. It's just like, you might need more help, I think. But yeah, hosting, I think, as a beginning comic is the best thing you can do.
How many years did you host?
I stopped hosting this year.
Yeah.
I hosted probably from my second year, like getting paid to host probably from my second year until this year. So I would say 5 years I hosted. And I stopped hosting on the road a while after I did Colbert. I stopped hosting on the road.
I see.
But still hosted in the city and stuff like that. And now since I started doing the Cellar, I started saying no to hosting because I just don't have time to do it.
We host a ton of shows, and you're right, getting those reps is important, but I'm kind of beating myself up now. I'm like, look, you got to find those, like you mentioned, those jokes in between sets to keep the energy moving, keep the show going.
Yeah.
We do some tricks, like we play music and stuff, so it would go without me, but I just think to get better, I think that's your opportunity to grow and get better, to your point.
Yeah. And it's, for a while I would always try and riff on the previous comic's last joke, or riff on the crowd, their reaction to that last joke or that last comic. Well, only if they did well. If they didn't do well, then don't.
You guys hated that, huh?
Yeah. Ooh, you guys seem unhappy. yeah. What happened? No.
What a train wreck, right?
I know. Nightmare. So I just that's being quick in between. Just keep the energy high. If the energy's already high and that person did well, just don't even, hey, that was great, let's keep it going, and then just keep going. But if it dips, you really gotta use your quickest jokes to get them back and happy again and set up the next comic on a high.
Yeah, I love the presence thing. I don't know if everyone else has the similar experience, but I in my transition of time doing comedy, I remember early on, I say that there was like a fog. It was just, the audience was in a fog. I was in my head. I was just trying to tell the jokes. They could drop a platter of crystal and shatter, and I would just plug right through. Yeah. And then as time has gone on, I found myself able to finally see the audience and hear the audience. And now I feel like as it's still progressing, I'm able to perceive better what the audience is thinking and hear myself and try to put myself in there. Oh, they, I said that weird. And they're thinking, I said, I meant this. And did you feel like you had a similar progression? Like, is that normal or how did it work for you? Were you always just very perceptive from the get-go?
No, not at all. I think I was like you, I was so intimidated by being on stage that I was just trying to remember the jokes. You know, one time I came up with cue cards trying to read it verbatim and I was like, what the fuck is this? And it bombed terribly. And so, yeah, I mean, it took a while. I remember one time it was like my first or second year doing comedy. I finally got booked on a show. It was a hostile show. So that means it's bad. It's a very bad show. It's a bunch of international drunk people who don't speak English sitting in a basement of a hostel in Bushwick and just being like, what is she talking about? You know, because they literally don't speak English. But I remember one time I was doing this show and I, of course, brought my friends because, you know, oh, guys, I'm like a professional. I was so bad. God damn, I was bad. But they came. I'm very supportive. I was very lucky. I was doing my jokes and something happened and a woman had been shouting out the whole time. And I just kind of ignored her or like would be like, oh, blah, blah, blah. Or just like, okay, you know, and then she came up and she literally gave me what looked like a, she just handed me a wooden dildo. That's what it looked like. It looked like a wooden dildo. Now I know it's something like a cheese maker, something dowel thing. I couldn't tell you.
I love it. Yeah.
I mean, she just handed it to me. She was like, do something with that. And like, I literally could not ignore the fact that she handed me a wooden dildo. I was like, well, I have no choice but to acknowledge what is happening. And then it was funny. I did well. With it as well as one could, but I mean, but I was literally that it shook me. So like, it was just like a slap in the face. It's like, well, now you have to be present. And that was, I think, the first time I ever really was like accepting to crowd work and understanding that the crowd is also part of the show. So
yeah,
it's weird.
That's true. That's going to be the foreword of your book. I want that on that story goes on the front.
Yeah.
You open the cover and there's that story.
I mean, it was so weird. She was just like, here you go. And she thought she was just like, we're having a nice time. We're just having a conversation.
You just like, became a prop comic in front of everyone.
Yeah. And then she left. So I couldn't even give it back to her. She left halfway through the show. And so I was like, what the fuck just happened?
Please say it's still on your shelf somewhere.
I do have it. It's in a box. I don't believe I threw it away. I don't know where it is. I've moved like four times since then, but I know for a fact I did not throw it away. So yeah, maybe I'll see a new comic and bequeath it to them. You know, just go to a bad hostel show and be like, here, you're welcome.
Pass the baton. Yeah.
Yeah. And they'll be like, this bitch just interrupted my set. I could never.
Was even a real person? She's like, yeah, it looked left, but maybe it was just in your head.
You
just
I know my dildo fairy godmother or something like that. Oh my God.
Well, weirdest thing to happen on. Is that the weirdest thing? We've had weirder.
Oh yeah, I've had weird conversations with people. I had a drink thrown on me once. That was fun.
For a joke? Because they were pissed about a joke?
No, they were very, very drunk and they were shouting at the, they were being racist and shouting at the comics and I was hosting. And at one point I just like, it was like the third or fourth time they'd been talked to and we didn't have enough security to kick them out because it was like a Tuesday Tuesday night, which is like, why would we need extra security on a Tuesday night?
But she was come out.
I know, it was so weird from Long Island, which okay, you know. And so I was like, and she was a rich woman. She kept talking about how much she had a trust fund and blah 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 blah. So I did crowd work with her because she kept interrupting the show. And that's probably when it switched from being nice Caitlin to being bitch Caitlin this moment right here. But I was like, hey, just because you got more money than us doesn't mean that you can treat us all like shit. And she was like, just do your jokes. And I was like, I'm trying. And she got up and she threw her drink across two aisles of people right on me. And then the guy next to me or next to her, the patron, threw his drink on her because he was mad that she threw her drink on me. And then they started fighting. And I was just on stage, just riffing, just started telling jokes. I leaned in and I saw what was happening, and people like were getting up to run away. And I was like, no, stay calm. Oh, I love the smell of Jack Daniels in the morning. I'm going to keep this on. This is my new perfume. We're having a nice time. Blah, blah. I blacked out. I have no idea what I said, but my friend was like, you did great. So
that is awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. It was bizarre. And then that woman got kicked out. And then we found out later that her husband had died like 2 days before. And we were like, that's why. Okay. But also don't come to a comedy show. Don't do that. You know, you think it's a good idea, but it's not the way you want to process your grief by getting very, very drunk and shouting at strangers who are just trying to make you happy. So yeah, that's probably the most bizarre thing that's happened to me on stage.
I'd love to hear more just about the journey. So from mm-hmm. doing all the open mics and now, like, you're a seller comic, you're touring, you're at Caroline's, like, what were the breaks? What got you to level up, I guess, through your comedy career? What happened that opened those doors?
I think the biggest thing, and I recommend this for all comics, especially newer comics, are comedy festivals. They helped me out so much. I got a 5-minute high quality, clean set. I was clean. You don't have to be clean. You just have to be funny, but mine happened to be clean and it helped me so much. I started getting into a bunch of festivals. I started traveling the country. I lost money. Don't get me wrong. You will be poor when you do this, because comedy festivals are not cheap, but they pay off in the long run, because not only did I start doing these festivals and getting seen by industry, but I also, met other comics and then worked with the clubs that now book me. So the Laughing Skull Lounge, the Limestone Comedy Festival, Comedy Attic, I still work there. And so I recommend that so much. And then I met like Ron on Hirschberg. I met Steve at a comedy festival, my boyfriend, Steve Rogers. We were just friends during that time. But we literally, you just meet so many people, and those people give you work and recommend you to other places. Yeah. And then it's basically, you're just trying to build your own network, and festivals are just the easiest, or at least the most approachable way of doing that. Because you literally apply to the festival, if you get in or you don't get in. But if you get in, you go, you have to literally stay with other people. You meet other comics. It's like going to summer camp for a weekend. Yeah. It's like comedy summer camp. Laughing Skull Comedy Festival is great. I've done that one a bunch. Limestone is great. You're literally forced to meet and mingle with all these people. It's really fun.
Literally forced. How does that?
Yeah. I mean, they do mixers. Like, they do mixers, and they put you on a bunch of shows, and it's different people every show. And you're literally forced to go to the after parties or go to these shows, and you're in the green room with strangers. And you meet them, you know, and if you want free food, you have to go into the green room or go to the after party, and everybody gets drunk and parties and does drugs, which, you know, you don't have to do. I didn't do the drug part, but I definitely did the drinking part. But yeah, they're so much fun. But mostly you're just building those connections, building those friendships that actually are genuine. And then they also help you down the road.
This is really intriguing to Drew and I. I know him and I are both at that level where we're excited to get accepted into our first festival, right? Mm-hmm. And so we've been submitting and trying to get good tapes in our room and all that stuff. And so we'll get there eventually. And I know a lot of comics that listen are at that level. So this is really good advice.
Yeah. I mean, having a good tape will save you so much time and energy. Just a 5 to 7 minute, very compact, like all your best jokes, just tight, tight, tight. No crowd work. Don't you go up there and fucking talk to the crowd. Don't curse unnecessarily. And I mean, you can get into a lot of places. Yeah, I can't recommend it enough. That one tape I got from this one festival, I got it at, I don't even think they do it anymore, Trial by Laughter. It was a show that they aired on the Comcast network where you had to be clean. And so I did this set of 5 minutes in the first round where I had to be, I was clean. And eventually that led to me getting Colbert. So,
yeah. So what, why the, how did your progression go from, was that just set clean or were you pretty much a clean comic and then kind of loosened up as you went?
Oh no, I am filthy. I've always been disgusting. I mean, just, I gravitate towards everything sexually icky, you know, I talk about cum all the time. Coming. Women need to come more. That's what I'm saying. But I, thank you. I will scream at you if you're not making a woman come. I just edited a clip. I'm probably going to release it tomorrow, but there's a clip where I'm like, I'm really like, are you going to make her come? You better go down on her. She's wearing leather fucking pants. Okay. Like, I'm just screaming at this guy. He's like, why am I here? And it's like,
aggressive crowd work.
Yes, very aggressive. But I understand, like dating Steve, I understand the merits of being clean and how important it is. It gets you a lot more work. So if you get a 20 minutes clean, you'll be fine. You know what I mean? You can do a pretty much any room. You can open for anybody and you can have 5 different sets for potential late nights. But I, at the time, only had about 10 minutes clean. And by that, I mean, I look back at it and I'm like, well, that joke sucks. But, you know, but it was pretty much, I had, what I ended up doing on Colbert, around that time. That's when I wrote that. But yeah, I did not start clean and I just literally wrote what I knew. And then I made them clean in order to do that festival.
I think there's something, and I think we're going to see a clip of it in a little bit and talk about it, but there's something about that performance that it's so, it's got this, I don't know how to, what the right words are, but maybe it's got this dirty energy. It's got this really, you don't know what's going to happen next kind of energy on stage, but it's a totally clean set. And it's really interesting as I'm watching, I was like, is she going to turn, it's a little edgy for late night. Sort of, not really.
Yeah, but it is. I talk about porn. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, I think it's part of your delivery too. You have such a fun, wild energy on stage that it feels like anything could happen, and you will follow any fun trail. Yeah, I've rarely seen people address the audience on a late night set, and that was super fun to see. Like she's really in the room. She's really present, even. On the television spot, you just don't see that. It was so fun.
Yeah, that's another one where I kind of blacked out doing the set. I just kind of just you go into auto, auto mode. Because I was able to be present in that one moment when that guy I meowed at a man. Oh my god, this is why I can't watch it. You guys have fun watching that, but. Yeah, I definitely growled like at this guy and he was just like, what? Like, he was so upset. But he was a good sport about it. But, I was very lucky in that the booker, Jessica Pilot, she was very encouraging. She saw me be clean and then she also saw me be dirty and she picked to work with me after she saw the dirty set. And she said she just liked my energy and how, and then I asked her like, do you want me to hold a mic? And she was like, no, love. And then they marked off on the stage where I could go. So they knew that I was going to walk around and move and get close. And they're like, you can't cross this line, but you can go here. So they wanted me to be myself, which was very nice. And they could have taken out the meow and the growl, but they didn't, they kept it in. And they also didn't cut any of my jokes, which is really nice. So my set ended up being like 7 minutes when the set is usually just 5. So I feel very lucky that Jessica pilot was so, she was very, very supportive and very helpful for me. And
that's awesome.
Encouraging. Yes, I got very lucky. But yeah, that I'm very much a proponent of muscle memory when it's something that terrifies you. So late night, I got it a little early. I think 4.5 years in.
Oh, wow.
four and a half years. Yeah, that's pretty early for a comic. Usually it's like after 8. Like, so I should just be maybe getting one now, you know. Mm-hmm. But they took a gamble with that only 5 minutes clean I had. And but I ran, I think, the set 30 times the week of. So that when I got there, because I knew I was going to be nervous, I knew I was going to shake and forget my line.
And you had to, the muscle memory probably helped you keep it clean, because you were 30 times. Yeah, you're just coming out there. Yeah. You're just, it's built into your DNA at that point.
Yes. Yeah. That's the goal. I don't know if you guys are former athletes, but that is okay. A little bit, not so much.
So, I mean, I wouldn't say I played sports. So I wouldn't call myself an athlete.
Yeah.
I actively play lacrosse.
Okay. Yeah.
40 years old. Yeah. Almost 40.
Yeah. Yeah. So you get it. It's like the thing, you learn the skill and you don't have to think about it. You know what I mean? Like, you know how to pick up the stick, you can twirl it, you can move the, you know exactly what to do with your hands without thinking about it. And so that for a set that terrifies you, you need to be like, I could say this in 2 minutes as fast as I can. I could say it backwards. I know everything about this set, so that when I get on stage, I just have to land the first line and my body will take over. And yeah. That's the way I approach it. I did that with my cellar audition too, because I'm prone to getting panic attacks on stage. So I was like, yeah, not today, Satan. So.
And what a magical moment that, you know, this thing, I think I mentioned in the email that Sam caught on Full Capacity, where you're just about to go and do your first set. That was so cool.
That was.
How'd it go, by the way?
Crazy. It went well. Yeah. I had a good set. I had a really good set.
The joke was great. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. It was, I was genuinely so intimidated. The first time, because I don't know if you know about the cellar audition, you usually do two auditions. Like, you do one at the, in front of Liz, who's the manager, at like the new joke night, like their open mic night for the comedians who are past. And so I did that during the pandemic. They had it in the Olive Tree in like this glass case. And I had a panic attack inside the glass case. And
you can see yourself. I hated those. You see your own reflection. It's the worst.
And if no one laughed, you're just like, who are these jokes for? Me. Oh my God.
You gotta look yourself in the face when you
it was awful. It was so bad. But I had a panic attack. I get lockjaw, I shake, I sweat. I get dry mouth. The lockjaw is the worst, because you're just like, and then I like, but I just powered through and I told my jokes, and she gave me the go ahead to audition for Esty, or send a tape to Esty. And then she decides if she wants to audition you. And so that's what happened. And she did. I had 5 days to prepare, which is crazy. What was I talking about? Fuck.
Just how it went.
Okay. I was like, I feel like I went on a tangent and now I'm totally fucking everything up. Yeah. And so I did that. Oh, and then I had 5 days to prepare. And so I just ran that set a million times because I was so scared that I was going to have another panic attack in front of Esty. And I ran it a bunch, went off fine, had a great set, got past. And then she told me to put in my availability right away. And so I got sets with it the week. So So I found out.
Congratulations on that. It's just so awesome.
Oh, thank you.
It's such a big deal. Like, every comic knows that to get past at the cellar is just like something every comic, and especially in New York, is just looking for. It's just such a validation. It's saying, hey, you're part of the squad. You're a top performer. You're someone we want to like, it's just such a great thing to be a part of. And so awesome. Congratulations on that.
Thank you. I mean, I used to go to the cellar before I did comedy, and I would sit in the back and watch Dave Attell on his late shows. And I would just be like, maybe one day I'll do an open mic, you know, and then I perform there regularly. It's like crazy to me. But I keep losing my space. Anyway, what was I talking? Oh, the Sam Morril thing. We're back.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're back.
So I didn't have a long time. And it was right after the pandemic. So literally all the clubs opened April 1st and I auditioned April 2nd. So luckily I was breaking the rules and performing in parks and on rooftops and shit. Otherwise I would not be prepared for that. Yeah. And then 5 days later I performed my first set and I was so intimidated by the cellar that I'd never really hung out there. So I physically did not know where to go. I didn't know how to get into the building. I'd never been to the VU before. And I was just like, I don't know where to be. I don't know who to ask. Are they going to know who I am? They're not going to let me in. I mean, you know, and I was just like literally standing outside spiraling when Sam came up and talked to me.
Camera crew. Yeah.
That's the moment they cut on camera.
Yes. Yeah. And so I'm literally like, how do you get into the building? I don't know.
Such a good
moment.
I'm
freaking out. And I honestly wasn't even thinking about my set. Like I was just like, I'm afraid to walk past these people. They have, you know, they look so intimidating, and then you meet them and they're the nicest people on the planet. And they already knew who I was. Hey, Caitlin, how's it going? It's like, I swear to God, they get a list of past comics and they have a picture. So they know to be like, oh, this person gets in. It's just a well-oiled machine. It's how every comedy club should be run.
A quick side note, we can say congratulations to, if you didn't see it, Gianmarco Ceresi, now a seller comic.
Oh, yeah.
Got past a veteran of the Breaking Down Bits, Mike.
Oh, yeah. He's great. He messaged me. He's like, I'm auditioning in 2 weeks. What do I do? And so I just gave him a bunch of advice. I think he had a great set. I wasn't there. I was on the road, but I heard he had a great set. So
sure he did.
Go get him, Tiger.
When you approach those, I mean, you've been doing it for a few months now, because I was back in April, right? There's a new expectation. Do you feel that? Do you feel that you have to show up with new material, new A material, faster and more? You know, is that a pressure that you feel?
No. Esty's only concern is that you kill. Yeah. So she does not care if you do the same material over and over again. We care, like I care. So at the beginning, I picked a set of 20 minutes that I could kind of cherry pick from and go in between for every 10 to 15 minute set. And now it's gone to 25 minutes, and then soon it'll be 30 minutes, you know? So I'm just trying to add jokes little by little to just spice it up and make it a little different. Like the first half I'll always do, it's the same like 6 to 7 minute set that I know kills. And then the second half I'll kind of do a little like something newer, never new. Oh my God. That terrifies me. But something that I'm working on or trying a new ending or something trying to fix. And then I always end the same way, which is very strong, with your closer. The expectation is only like your job is only to kill. That's it.
And that's a good transition to writing. We always want to know, answer the question however you want, but how does Caitlin Peluffo write comedy?
Oh, it's so annoying. I write on stage. It's the worst. I don't recommend it at all. It's awful. I try and be like Steve Rogers and sit down with my little notebook and be like, this is what I think is crazy about lamps, you know? I'm so jealous. I'm so, so jealous. But I'll like literally think of an idea, write it down in my notebook, maybe write a page on it if I can even muster that. And then I go to either an open mic or a bar show that I'm booked on, and I will try and talk it out. And usually the adrenaline of trying to find the laugh makes me think quickly. And but now I'm getting less nervous on stage, so that's not working. So
you're too comfortable on stage to write on stage.
Exactly. So now I'm like, yeah, that didn't work. And now I'm like, fuck. Now I gotta. God damn it. So I'm trying the thing where I think of a topic and I write a page on it, and I try it that way, and then Steve and I sometimes will talk it out, or I'll talk it out with someone else. I'll be like, what do you think of this tag, or what's that, you know? And, but usually it's on stage riffing, and then just in my little phone notes, writing down an idea. But it takes me a long time to get new bits. It takes me like a month to get a new, like, 2-3 minutes, just because it is a slower process for me. Whereas Steve did an album and he already has another hour. It's like, oh, God.
That guy's full of, he's full of material. He's cranking it out.
I mean, it is obnoxious. I love that man so much, but he makes me so jealous with all of his writing.
Did you always write on stage like that? Or did, when you started, were you a pen to paper kind of gal? And then as you kind of got the tools, you transitioned into on stage writing.
I tried so hard to be a pen to paper, you know, like a monologue writing, joke writing, because that's what I thought you were supposed to be. Even though the first time I did comedy, I was riffing because I didn't have any jokes. So I just talked about stuff I thought might be funny. Mm-hmm. And it did well. Like I was like, oh, I built a cadence and I knew what a natural punchline was. But I tried so hard to just be the pen to paper type of person. But yeah, this one I kind of just like accepted it and was like, well, you're just going to have to do a million spots a week. That's just going to be your life. So... yeah.
So all the stage time kind of facilitates the onstage writing because you can go up and, because I'm assuming, because I am not necessarily, I'll grab a tag or like an audience interaction will inspire something, but I am not an onstage writer. Mm-hmm. But does that mean that a lot of your open mic sets, sometimes nothing really happens? You kind of just talk around something. Does that happen a lot? And then you finally have the ones that are successful and really craft something?
Yes. Correct. I bomb a lot.
Well, you're taking a risk. That's a huge risk to come up on stage without a joke and just hope that you're going to kind of put that puzzle together live in front of people. And it's just, there's no way it's going to happen every single time.
Well, my theory with open mics is you got to tell one quick joke at the beginning so that they know that you're funny, you know, and then you do the bad stuff after, and then you just get off when you see the light. But never worry about ending strong at a mic. Who gives a shit? But you always want to start strong. But less than 30 seconds. Just a 30 second quick. Like I did this one joke. Steve and I went to an open mic. You guys will get a kick out of this because he's Steve. It's also disgusting. So get ready. But like I did an open mic with Steve and I went up there and he went on right before me. And I was like, that's my boyfriend. He claims to be a picky eater, but he eats ass. So he claims to have never had soup, but I've had soup, motherfucker. So it's, just something like that, you know, just a quick little like, okay, we're laughing. She's funny. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then I proceeded to tell a 3-minute story that went nowhere. So
at first I was like, okay, so she's going to end on a low, she's okay with ending on a note, the low note. And she goes, who cares? And I was like, oh, that's not that you're burying the comic after you, but it's the host's goddamn job to pick that mic back up. So you're right. Yeah. Who cares?
Who cares? It's also an open mic. It's supposed to be bad.
Right. Yeah, well, exactly. And a lot of like I've heard, you know, obviously we're not in New York. So a lot of, I think our stage time in Houston and maybe other cities are the same. Most of our mics, you know, we have a lot of 5-minute mics. We have a couple of 7-minute mics.
An actual audience.
Goodness. Yeah. What a luxury.
And it seems like in New York, a lot of times it's 3 minutes. So you can't, you only have so much prop real estate to work with. So if you're trying to tell a closer every time, you're just wasting, you know, precious time that you could be workshopping a new joke.
Exactly. Yeah, you don't have, in New York, you don't have the luxury of time or an audience. You literally have your peers, and they will let you know if something's bad. You'll just see someone, like, look away and just, oh, God, you know. There's nothing worse than the, ugh.
But do you feel like they let you know when something's good? Because I know, like, you know, when comics, when you're performing to just comics, you know, like, in Houston, you know, sometimes it's not, you get no response. These guys are, unless you're telling something that's like kind of directed towards the back of the room, you don't get a lot of feedback. In New York, do you feel like the comics maybe give a little more feedback or no?
I think they do just because of the sheer amount of comics. Like if you go to Pine Box, there's 40 to 50 comics doing 2 minutes each. And so it's just the amount of people who are there. And it's a mix between new comics who don't know any better and old grizzled, like, why the fuck am I here? So I think in that way you also learn which mics to go to, where people aren't going to be on their phones and just totally checked out. And then it also, you go to the mics where your friends are, and your friends are going to want to watch you, you know, and they'll let you know, because they don't want to, they want to be friends with someone who's booked. So it's like, they're not like, you were great. And then just be like, she sucks. Like, it's very honest in New York, I feel. But I've also, I haven't been that into the open mic scene for a few years now. So I don't know if it's changed at all. I know. Thank you. I'm booked. So maybe that's why I haven't written anything in a goddamn year. Steve tells me it's pretty much the same. He doesn't do a lot as well, but the ones he does go to, it's like he goes with his group of friends and they all talk about, they give tags and stuff. So it's all very helpful.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think, you know, a lot of times, I know when I was just starting comedy, I came from playing music and being in a band. Mm-hmm. It's a team sport. Mm-hmm. And then you go to comedy and you think, oh, it's a lone wolf thing. It's just me. But then you start to, as you get into the scene, you realize like there's a lot of collaboration going on behind the scenes, and it's absolutely necessary. You need people that you write with and work with and get feedback from. It's absolutely not a solo sport in that sense.
Mm-hmm. 100%. Yeah. No one's an island, as they say in About a Boy with Hugh Grant. yeah. How'd you like that reference? Just you gotta get current.
I think there is a period for new comics. There is a period where you are lone wolf, though. You got the four months or whatever it is before you can make a friend, a true friend, and you just gotta you gotta go through that period of time.
Yeah,
and eat shit.
But if you are that, if you are that new comic, then just know that there are plenty of other new comics. So just go sit next to someone who's all by themselves and be like, "Hi, want to be awkward together?"
That's how I met Brian. Brian and I met at an open mic.
Oh, it's a love story.
We kissed on the first mic. Yeah,
a bromance was formed.
Yeah. Oh, that's what that thing is on your lip. A fun herpes joke.
He hates when I call him my hetero life mate.
Stop doing that. Yeah.
I think it's sweet.
Jay and Silent Bob reference, if we're going to throw out movie references.
You're both wearing backwards hats. This is
good. We didn't coordinate that. I'm going to turn mine around. This is the new riot hat. Hey, you're doing the show in January. We're excited to have you.
I'm excited. It's the weekend after my birthday. I'm going to be 35 and sad. So let's do it.
30s are the best.
So we talked about set list. We kind of talked about set list design. One thing we ask comics is, what do you do right before you go on stage? You can have these panic attacks. Mm-hmm. What do you do to make sure to reduce
your pre-show ritual?
Your pre-show ritual. Do you have anything you do to kind of?
Yeah, it's freak out and cry. My therapist, my old therapist, she helped me. She was like, well, if the thing is that you shake it out first. Oh. So I will literally be in the hallway, shaking. I have a water bottle in my hand to make sure I don't get dry mouth. And then it's as soon as the first joke hits, the panic is gone. It's literally the 5 minutes before my set, or when the person before me gets the light. That's when I'm like, fuck, you know, what's gonna happen? You know, it's like surrendering control. And I'm not a person who likes to do that, but you have to do it in order for the show to be good. So
shake it out. Like this shake it out. Our millions of listeners are all going to shake it once after hearing this. It's going to change the rotation of the earth because of this advice. This is
perfect. Yeah. I mean, mentally, you're telling your brain, you're not going to shake. I'm going to shake. Choose to shake.
That's right. You're taking ownership of that's actually really valid. I like that a lot. I'm doing it tonight.
Do it. Yeah. Shake it out. And then breathing exercises, the in for four, hold for four, out for four. That helps a lot, but the shaking seems to be the thing that works best for me.
And there's gotta be a lot of pressure because you're probably at this point working with some people that you probably really looked up to and have maybe been like staples. And I mean, you're opening up for Colin Quinn and these guys who are just like, man, everyone knows this is the SNL guy who's mm-hmm. just career is kind of legendary, and you're on stage with them. There you are. I know I would feel like a lot of pressure to be like, am I supposed to be here?
Oh, all the time. I remember the first week I was at the Cellar, I went on stage, had a good set, came off stage, and there was Dave Attell sitting on the stairway, and he's my idol. He's been my favorite comic since, like, I think middle school. And I saw him, and he was like, how were they? And I was like, they were really fun. I think you're going to have a good time. And he looked at me, and he goes, no, I won't. And then he just got into the room. And it was just like, it made me laugh so hard. He's like, no, I won't.
That's the quintessential Dave Attell response, probably.
Yeah, he's so funny. But he's the one I still get nervous around, even though he's been nothing but nice and is very approachable and very kind. But I don't think he realizes how much he means to so many comics, or maybe he does realize it, and that's why he's just like, I don't even want to know, don't tell me, we're just going to talk about jokes, here's my, where can I find a new punchline, what's a new tag, you know. Mm-hmm. I also had to follow Ronnie Chang, and that was tough. That was, I mean, not tough, but it was like, oh gosh, they like threw bras at the stage. Last night I had to follow Andrew Schultz dropped in, and he was just working on new material, and he destroyed. And then the hardest follow I feel is Godfrey, just because he's the most talented human being on the planet, maybe. Just, he was doing character voices, he was beatboxing, he rapped, he did accents, like it was just incredible. And then it was like, well, no, I'm gonna do my little dick jokes, how you doing? So, but it's fun. I think that's what makes you stronger, is learning how to follow these people, you know, learning how to change your energy a little bit, or get louder, or, you know, what jokes to start with to keep their attention. And
I love that. That was a trick. So I recently did my first headlining set, and I put up one of the funniest guys in the scene as my opener, or, you know, the guy right before me, to make sure I would have to match that energy and step up my game. I just thought that would make me stronger. I think it worked. I don't know.
Yeah, it is. It's important. A lot of people go on the road and they want kind of like, they always want good comics, but they want someone who's low energy so that they can raise the energy easily. Which I get. I understand that mentality.
So book me. I'm right here. I'm
But it's interesting. So when someone like has the high energy, you really got to come and just really, I think the high energy people really make the show better. They like bring it up a notch, you know? But it's tricky, you know, following
you're one of those people.
Not easy.
You're definitely
you bring a very great energy to the stage. Even if you were just speaking nonsense, I think you would still be funny, because the energy and the there's just something, your performance side of your game is strong.
Oh, thank you. Maybe it's, you know how you get in your head, you're just like, oh, I'm all dance and no salsa. No. I don't know. I tried an analogy. It didn't work.
there's plenty of substance in the jokes, but you have both sides of the coin, which is, I think those are the people that pop off when they're great writers, but they also know how to perform, because, you know, there's some guys that are great writers and they get up and they just like stand still and do their jokes. Mm-hmm. And that's great. And they're genius writers, but there's something that the audience really loves about someone who can really bring it to life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
let's catch a clip of it. You were just talking about them not cutting out your jokes. I'm probably gonna cut it in half, so that I
apologize. Please, God,
And also, Jesus. Stephen Colbert is in the beginning. I couldn't cut him out, so he's eating up our time. And
that asshole.
All right, so let's probably about 3 minutes in. Okay.
Okay, I'm gonna disappear. Thank you.
Okay.
Hey everybody, welcome back to the Late Show. Ladies and gentlemen, my next guest tonight is a stand-up comedian who performs regularly at the New York Comedy Club, making her network television debut. Please welcome Caitlin Peluffo.
Hey. Y'all ready to hear some jokes from Butch Laura Croft, huh? I don't have a Laura Croft body. No, I have an in-betweener body. I'm not fat, but I'm also not thin. Very muscular, played a ton of sports, so I call this softball skinny. Thank you. Thank you. I had to learn to like this body, though, because I was this size in sixth grade. That's a gigantic child. So my dad, he was smart about it, shoved me in every sport there was to play, and I was pretty good. So I kept getting that compliment. I'm sure some of the guys in here have heard it. Hey, Caitlin, you're a real beast out there. Yeah, you're such a beast. Oh, that's not a compliment. I'm 12. You just told me I'm the worst part of my favorite movie. I mean, that's horrible. No 12-year-old girl wants to be the beast. No, we want to be Belle. We want to be the beautiful princess, not the monster who is ugly as a punishment. I mean, what was my crime? What did I do wrong? Dominate third base? Because you know I did. Thank you. At this point, I would like to let everybody know that I am not gay. I get it. I'm wearing a lot of denim. Did you know that women can just be comfortable? Yeah. Doesn't mean we're gay. And I don't care if you do think I'm gay. It doesn't offend me. I just bring it up so all the single fellas know. Yeah, I'm gonna try and fast pitch into your heart. It's just tough dating because I'm a strong gal, I'm a bigger gal, and I am attracted to pretty men. Oh no. Because I like them really pretty. Yeah, I want a guy so pretty I'm getting fist bumps from lesbians. That's a pretty guy. Yeah, I want them to look at him and be like, damn girl, he looks soft. I like him soft. But the soft ones, they don't like girls like me. No, they want a girl with a thigh gap. I have never in my life had a thigh gap. I have, however, created holes in my jeans from my thighs. People call it chub rub. I call it power friction, okay? Oh, yeah. Don't you look away. You look at this, all right? You look right here, buddy. Huh? You drink this in, okay? When you see a woman with holes here, she can deadlift your Vespa, okay?
I had to end on that moment.
Watching it without the sound is insane. It's literally just me pointing at my crotch for 15 seconds. Jesus Christ.
So performance. It's inspiring to me as somebody who tries to be more physical on stage that just gives jokes the extra. You're one of the best I've seen doing it in a while. We watch a lot of comedy.
Oh, thank you. You're very nice. Mm-hmm. I'm basically Lady Tommy Boy, I feel like, whenever I watch that.
I'm a huge fan of Tommy Boy. Physical.
Oh, it's my favorite movie. Favorite comedic movie of all time. I know. They put it for free on Netflix. I already own it. I'm like, fuck. Fuck you.
One thing that always catches me, it's probably a stupid thing to always think about, but performing without a microphone, I feel like it's Talladega Nights and all over again. And was that strange? You seem super comfortable doing it. Did it feel comfortable?
Yeah, it was, but I had to work at it. Joe List, you probably know of him. Great comic. Sure. Also my neighbor, very fun.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, we live in the same building. He got us our apartment. Sweet man. Nice. But he told me and Steven when we were preparing for Colbert, He was like, if you use a microphone, it's going to cover half of your face. And this is a time when America can see your face. So just don't use a microphone. And he never uses a microphone on any of his. And he was like, you just kind of, so we would go to open mics, put the mic aside and shout, or just leave it in the stand and move your hands. Because the first time you do it, you're like, where is it? You know, but so by the time I was doing it, it was fine. So whenever it was like an intimate audience, I would be like, hey, is it okay if I don't use the mic? Great, thanks. And then I would jump into it. Yeah.
That's kind of ballsy right there, even just to be like, mic here, let's go.
Oh, sometimes I do these shows and I'm like, I'm a loud bitch. This is only for you, you know, like this, you feel like I should have a microphone, but I don't need one, you know? So.
And then I was talking to some newer comics and really, you know, people just getting started, and this set, you know, you really lean into, you look like, and that's such a good prompt, as you admitted, you're fairly new, 4 years in before you got your late night set. Mm-hmm. And it is, like, it's your introduction to the world in some ways. So you want to have this intro type thing. But yeah, leaning into that heavily on this material is a good strategy.
Yeah, it was, I don't know. It's the quickest way just for them to be like, yeah, you do look like that, you know? And it's just like, if you do it in a way that is self-deprecating, but not mean, it's, you know, they're like, she's going to, we're fun. I also feel like, you know, like it's fun to be silly about not take yourself so seriously.
If you go too mean, they're like, oh, I feel bad for it. But yeah, if it's as long as it's done in a silly way, in a fun way.
Yeah, exactly. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. As far as like the majority of your material goes, you know, when you really started to get out there, a lot of biographical material, is it a lot about yourself? And is that, I feel like my guess is that that's maybe a good strategy for a person. Like you want maybe your first special or your first thing you kind of put out there is about you, so people can get to know you. Is that track, or any thoughts on that?
Yeah. I mean, again, Jola said like, you can't steal someone's material if you're writing about yourself. So like, and not steal, but like, you can't really have overlapping ideas if you're talking about yourself, you know, there's no worry about, what is that term?
Parallel thought.
Yeah. So I do have it a little bit with my one friend, Amy Miller, because, we both talk about being strong women with small boyfriends who have big dicks. And so there's like, I know, Steve. You'll hear all about it in January.
Yes.
Steve's about 30. I got about 15 minutes on Steve, but, yeah. So it's, so sometimes there's that parallel thing, but we have different jokes, so it's fine. But it is something that I have to be aware of. I either don't watch her or I usually just don't watch her, but she is my friend, so I enjoy watching her. There's one joke that's kind of parallel. It is parallel thought for sure. But it's about how we date small men because they can't kill us. And, but her joke is different from my joke. So it's fine, but it's still, in terms of that. I definitely write biographical because you have to write about what you know. And so what I know is everything to do with myself. It sounds insanely narcissistic, but it's the only thing that I've done, I would say. Everything that I say on stage has come from, you know, an action or a thought that I have had about my life in my past. So, yeah.
Sure. I like that sort of stuff. I think it's super interesting, like when comics get up and don't do stuff about themselves so much, you know, like maybe like, I don't know, a comic kind of like Anthony Jeselnik, who just comes up and kind of has these great misdirect jokes, not a lot of personal material in there.
Mm-hmm.
Love the jokes, but I'm drawn to people who are a little vulnerable. Maybe I think I definitely lean into those comics a little more personally.
Yeah. Same. I definitely lean into the personal, because it is, it's vulnerable and it's, you feel kind of, like you made a friend at the end of their set, you know, like I know this person, I know who they are. I think you want to see more, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That's the stuff you're going to remember. You're not going to remember what one random person thought about climate change, you know.
Also, do you use, I feel like doing watching that set, eye contact. Do you, I feel like when I was doing comedy a lot earlier, I was always looking at my feet. I was never, and now that I'm being intentional to watch the crowd, it does kind of open up some opportunities, and you definitely found some opportunities even in that set.
Yeah. That's one thing that's never, being on stage. Yes, I get nervous beforehand, but being on stage, I've never really felt uncomfortable. And even growing up and stuff, I was always like center of attention, trying to be, you know. And I've never had fear of public speaking. Once I start doing it, I'm just like, well, we're here, you know. And eye contact is something that I use to my advantage. Like now, if a guy's uncomfortable, I will crouch down and say directly into his eyes my next joke and be like, are you gonna laugh now? You have to look at me, you know, like it's aggressive.
It's also super present. It's the most present you can be in someone's face telling a joke to them.
Literally just like, hi. Yeah. God, that's my favorite thing to do when it's like a tough guy and he's just looking past, you know, he's not even looking at me. I just like to go, excuse me. Hi. Hi. I'm up here. How's it going? And he's just like, oh.
So let's go ahead and run it. I'm going to do our last segment. This is going to be a little weird, so stick with it. It's called Last Laugh. Here it comes. All right, breaking down bits. Here lies a funny comedian. Sorry, Caitlin. So what we need from you is the joke that will be written on your tombstone, the joke to be remembered by. It can be yours, can be somebody else's. What is your last laugh?
Yeah, it could be one of my, I guess it would be one of my own. It'd be weird if it was someone else's. I love this one joke I do every set. I love it. I'll just tell the whole thing, I guess. I love pretty boys. Pretty boys are great because they got those high cheekbones, easier to sit on. You got to sit on faces. Ladies, fight the patriarchy. Sit on a man's face. Did you know when you sit on a man's face, they have to shut up? It's wonderful. What was that about the wage gap? Boop, have a seat. Yeah, do it for Ruth. God bless her. RGB sat so we could also sit. So, yeah, it's very fun.
Are you running for office?
Yeah. I know. It's my only political joke, even though I do take down Woody Allen. No, I don't. But... it is, it's one of my favorite jokes, and it is quick, and it, you find out real fast if, people are going to like the rest of my set. If they're on board with the face sitting joke, then we're going to have a good time.
That's the temperature, the temperature taker.
Yes. That's my dip the toe. I do that about 3 minutes in, 3 or 4 minutes into my set. I go, hello. And then if they're like, okay, then I'm like, we're going to have a nice time. Here we go.
Nice. Do you, sorry, I'm going to ask one last question that we're trying to get here. One thing that me and Brian have been talking about, like sometimes, you know, if the crowd's not with you, quick techniques on what you do when the crowd, you dip the toe, they're not liking it. How do you edit? What do you do differently?
Oh, nothing. I mean, I just did a gig where this happened. It was very rich old people that I was performing for, and I bombed my dick off. I just, I hadn't had a good bomb in a long time, and I was like, oh, this, here we are, you know, feels right. But at one point, like, I used to, like, try crowd work. You know, oh, you don't like these jokes. Let's talk a little bit. See if I can get you to loosen up. And if they're not into that, then I, despite my me knowing better, I'll dig in and I'll just be like, oh, you didn't like my dirty jokes? Well, I'm going to double down and we're going to talk about fisting now. So this is what you get. I wish I had the capacity to just be like, okay, I'll do my Colbert set. I'll keep it clean, you know, or I'll try and do more act outs. But I'm like, if you're not laughing at like three of my favorite jokes, then I don't want you to like me. So it gets like a little bitter.
Yeah, right. So-
but yeah, I wish I had the, because some people can, like Steve can switch speeds You know, he'll do crowd work, be present, like, and then do different jokes about different things and try and find something that works. And now I'm just like, well, here we are.
When you have 8 hours of material in your back pocket, I guess you can.
Yeah. Just pick a different hour, Steve. I have no advice to give on that.
Stick to your guns. Just be you all the way.
Yeah. Through. Cause I did leave and like maybe a handful of people out of that 60 person room were like, I thought you were so funny. And it's just like, well, you didn't laugh, but thank you. I think I said at one point, one person laughed at one joke and I was like, follow me on Instagram. Oh boy, it was so bad, but what are you going to do? They happen. You bomb, you're not for everybody. And that's fine. It's not the end of the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What can you do? Well, tell everyone how they can find you on the interwebs, whatever your social media website, whatever you want to share.
Sure.
Let people know how they can follow you on Instagram and other things.
Yeah, Instagram, I'm at Caitlin Peluffo. It's right on the screen here, at CAITLINPELUFFO. And then my website is literally CaitlinPeluffo.com. I have a bunch of tour dates up there. I'm going to be in Portland, Oregon, going up to the National Comedy Center to help Steve tape his special.
Yeah.
I know. I'm going to have to be clean for 10 minutes. Motherfucker. and then I'm coming out to you guys. The Riot. So yeah, that'll be fun.
Texas,
I'm going to Louisville Hall. I'm going everywhere. Jesus Christ. I really got to update my website. But I also have a podcast called Good Time Gal, which is about drunk stories. I interview comics and we talk about the best times that they were ever wasted. And it's very silly and very fun. That's me in a nutshell. Woohoo.
Ooh, that's a lot of fun. Well, everybody check out Caitlin online or at the World Famous Comedy Cellar in New York.
World Famous Comedy. I think it's hilarious that it's called the World Famous Comedy Cellar. It's hysterical to me. But I mean, I get it. Basement. Like all the shows are sold out and it's good.
Yeah.
But, like
it's
still.
Pretty awesome.
It's the World Famous. It just seems like a, anyway.
It's all right.
Well, I mean, it's like the Super Bowl. We're not world champs. It's a Super Bowl. Yeah,
you are a world champ, damn it.
My God, you're trying to get me naked. Okay.
Stick around for our Patreon.
You just see my nipples.
All right. Hey, thanks for joining us, Caitlin. Thanks so much for listening. This has been Breaking Down Bits.
Bye. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to Breaking Down Bits. You can keep in touch or get more when you follow at Breaking Down Bits on social media, visit the website breakingdownbits.com, or shoot us an email at breakingdownbits@gmail.com.